There's a young guy, just got in the business, you know, he's fired up, and he gets on the phone and he's doing some phone calls. You know, he's got his list there, being told, you know, make a list. So he's made out his list, and he rings up this first guy, and he says, "Do you ever look at other ways of making money?" And this guy says, "Is it Amway?" I never can work out how they get that out of that, except they know there's money in Amway. Maybe? So the guy says, "Well, what do you know about it?" And this guy says, "It only comes out at night. It's got six legs. It's covered in scales, PV scales. I think that means pretty vulgar. It's got no head, but amazing vision. And if you ever see one, don't pick it up. I know people who have, and they've never been the same since." So, people just don't know what we do, do they? And that's because of us. That's our problem, you know? It just means we haven't got out there enough. So we just got to get busy. And this next 12 months is the time to get busier than you have ever been in your entire life. It is the most exciting thing. There's not too many things that you can be in for a long time and be more fired up 13 years later. When we started this 13 years ago, we had no idea what we'd got into. And with what's about to happen, you guys have just got no comprehension of what you're in. It's almost like we've accidentally stumbled on one of the greatest concepts in the world. So strap yourselves in, because it's just going to be an amazing, amazing year. But it takes me back, I think, when I think of that, how easily we might not have been here. And there's a lot of you guys in this room I know who are dreamers, and dreaming's not a problem. You just believe absolutely without any problems. But there's some of us who weren't like that and aren't like that. And I don't know if there's anyone in the room that has sort of got to a point where it's like, life's dealt out enough and I'm not going to take any more. And it's like, I can't dream anymore because all of my life I've dreamt and it's gone wrong. As we were growing up, you know, we had all these great things we wanted to do and all these fantastic things we wanted to do with our life. And whether it was somebody let us down or whether it was, we lost jobs, we lost loved ones, it just didn't turn out the way we wanted. And it's like, rather than risk one more time hoping that things might change, it's easier to give up and easier not to get our hopes up, easier not to think that. It's not just easier, it doesn't hurt. It doesn't hurt anymore if I can just give up on it. If I can just find a quiet corner and just live my life out, exist the rest of it out in a quiet little place where no one else can hurt me anymore. I don't know if there's anyone that's like that, but that's what I felt like. When we saw the business, even as we were building the business, so much had been taken away, and I remember just so many nights we'd go out and try and build the business and things would look good, and then it didn't go as fast as we hoped, or something went wrong, and it was like every time I wanted to hope, something had come along and hurt again. And I'd got to a stage, I think, in my life that I just didn't want to hurt anymore. I just honestly wanted to die. I really did. I remember just sitting down in front of the fireplace one night. I got back from the dairy. It was really cold. The kids were hungry. There was nothing in the cupboards. And I was stoking up the fire, and I was just kneeling there, and I went to light it, and even the stupid match wouldn't work. And the carpet was all burnt and scorched and, you know, threadbare in front of it was an old farmhouse. And I just thought, "Lord, I just want to go home." But he had other plans. And I just got something to let you know that wherever you are today, he has other plans. Much as you might like to think it's going to be so much easier just to fall out, it's exactly the opposite. He has an amazing thing ahead for you. And it's funny the things that turn your thinking, you know. And We went across to America this year, back then, in that particular year. And this guy came out onto the stage, and he was introduced. I'd never heard of him before. I was in a coliseum for the fired up out of the tree people, you know, and they were screaming. It was just the most exciting place I'd ever been in my life. And this man came out onto the stage, and he was all, his face was all distorted and scarred, and it was really, it was horrifying when he first came on the stage. It was sort of like I couldn't believe it. And he started to tell his story, and he said during the Vietnam War, he was with some of his platoon, whatever they're called, and they were clearing scrub, and he was holding a phosphorus grenade, and he was about to throw the grenade into the scrub, and a sniper bullet hit the grenade and blew the phosphorus up, and it went all over him. It covered his face, his whole body. And phosphorus doesn't just go out in water, but instinctively he jumped into the water, but the phosphorus kept burning. And I was horrified listening to what he was saying. And he said, and I saw my face float away. I saw my chest come away and separate from me. And then he said, ever felt beside yourself? Like, I was ready to cry, and he's joking. So then he says, his mates pulled him out of the water, and they wrapped him up in a blanket, and they threw him on a stretcher, because even though the air was still getting to the phosphorus, and so he burnt through the stretcher. And he said, and wouldn't you know it, I fell on my head. So they picked him up again, and by this time they figured he must have been well and truly dead, and they raced him to this helicopter, and they threw him in with all the other bodies. And the helicopter pilot's about to take off, and he was a bit nervous because he knew that when they die during the war, they take the dog tags off and they push them up into their gums, and he was really scared that they were going to do that to him. So he let out a grunt. Well, the helicopter pilot thought everyone was dead. He lost control of the helicopter. And the guy said, I knew what had happened. The helicopter would crash, he'd be killed, and I'd be the sole survivor. So they finally got him into hospital. And by the time they got him there, he was just a black, scarred, just a mess. He was unrecognisable. And he was laying next to another guy who'd been really badly burnt too. And the guy next to him was waiting for his wife to come in. And he was only just holding on to life. And this other man's wife came in, took one look at the man on the bed, and she took her wedding rings off and threw them on the bed and walked out. And he died not long afterwards. And Dave was laying beside him thinking, I know my wife loves me, but is she going to love this? And he really thought there was no point going on. So he pulled the tube and he laid there and waited to die. He said, 2 hours later I got hungry, I'd pulled the wrong tube. So eventually, his wife came into the hospital ward, and she walks up to him, and she says, and he's waiting to hear her response, how she's going to respond to him. And during their most intimate times, in times past, she always called him Davy. And she came around his bed, and she knelt beside him, and she said, welcome home, Davy. And then for the next weeks and weeks of his operations and operations and operations, she'd come in and she'd say, top of her voice, she'd say, when are you going to let him come home, Doc? You know I can do more for him in a night than you can do for him in a week. And, he was operated on so many times. He had no ears, no nose. There was just no facial features. And everything had inflated so much that his head looked like a bowling ball. And he said he was walking along the street, and he was driving in his car. He finally got out of hospital and he was driving in his car, and a lady was coming through at what she was facing a red light, but all she could see was this bowling ball in a car. So she was so busy looking at the bowling ball, she went straight through the red light. And so he had to put on his brakes and stop really suddenly, which meant the car behind him pranged into him. So the person behind him jumps out of the car, races up to tell him off, takes one look at the bowling ball, jumps back in the car and locks all the doors. And as he was standing on stage, he said, most exciting things happen. They've given me a thumb. And he holds up his hand like this. And he takes his thumb off and shows everybody, puts it back on. And he says, it means I can play the piano again, because he loves to play the piano. So they pull out a piano and he sits down. He says, actually, I play by ear. And he takes his ear off and he starts banging up and down the keyboard. And today, he goes into... Oh, at that point, he then said, we left America fighting a war that we didn't want to fight. And we came home to a country that hated us. And no one welcomed us home. And he said, tonight I want everyone in this Coliseum to welcome home the Vietnam veterans. And he asked all the Vietnam vets to come down onto the stage. And men started to pour down out of the Coliseum with no arms and no legs and blind. And they were all crying, and so were we. And they all came down to the stage, and they were holding each other, and they stood on the stage, and the applause started, and it didn't stop for hours. Because he knew that if you heal the inner man, the outer man's fine. And Dave spends his years now going around high schools all around America teaching about drug abuse, teaching about morals, about healing, taking young kids whose lives are heading in all sorts of amazing directions and bringing them back together. But he could have died. He had a choice. He could have let go. But he's turned his life into a magnificent victory. You're in this room because you're to turn your life into a magnificent victory. That's why you're here. There's so many things I think that I could say, but I know John's got a lot of things that he's going to share with you now, but I think the greatest thing that you can do as you're building this business is accept it to be true and believe it. As you're building the business, you know, there's lots of people that you're going to talk to who will logically get into the business. That there's everyone should logically be building the business. It's so clear. We're in an era where there's no financial security. We're in an era where there really isn't any guaranteed superannuation funds at the end. So we haven't really got job security. Where most of us, I'm speaking on your behalf, but most of us haven't got much in the bank. There's not much there, is there? And we might have some equity in our homes, but that's about all we've got. We can't really sustain any emergency. So it's like we're right on the edge of the line, aren't we? So logically, it is the greatest business for people, for all of us, because not many of us have got the reserves to go out and invest in any great ventures. So logically, it is the best business to be in. But you know, logic will never get you to diamond. Only passion and the will to win will. And the only way you get passion is to believe in what you're doing. And the only way you get belief is accept it to be true. It's time to accept it to be true. And we know that we're going to share the world. We're going to share beaches, we're going to share trips, we're going to share exciting times ahead with you guys. Can't wait. So here's my hero, here's John Hargraves. Thank you.
It's great to be here and to see all you guys here, because we're all here for a purpose and a reason, aren't we? And we're all in this business because we need to give hope to the people here in this country, don't we? They all need hope, lots of hope. You know that you're actually designed for a purpose. You have a destiny and a purpose, every single one of you. Do you know what your purpose or your destiny is? You need to pursue that. Ray Kroc, I think, was 67 when he discovered his purpose in life, which became the McDonald's hamburger chain, didn't it? Well, you can be quite old by the time you discover it. The important thing is you continue to look for it. Well, you pursue your destiny and your purpose. You've been given gifts and abilities to do that. A lot of people you mix with, you'll find they're in a survival mode, aren't they? TGIF, thank God it's Friday. That's what they live for, don't they? That's a survival mode. Anyone who's going around talking that sort of attitude, you don't ever want to fall into that trap. You've been given so many gifts and abilities, and we need to draw them out of you so that you can achieve your destiny and purpose. And you need to be in success mode. And I want to talk about some of those things tonight. And so that you have, in a success mode, you've got drive and inspiration, and you're out there, out on the cutting edge. If you've got that thank God it's Friday attitude, you're living under delusion, and you're never ever going to live a significant life. We all human beings desire to be significant, don't they? If they're really honest, we all would like to be significant in some form to other people, and that's what this business allows you to do.